Following cultural practices designed to produce healthy, vigorous plants can prevent many diseases. Plants that are properly spaced, pruned, fertilized, and watered are much less prone to problems than plants that are exposed to undesirable environmental conditions. Improper irrigation management, especially overwatering in the propagation or container production areas, predisposes plants to infection by diseased organisms. A nursery grower should use a holistic approach that gathers all existing information on potential and existing disease problems to organize a coordinated effort against pathogens in all phases of the nursery operation. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and this video discusses the types of diseases in nursery production, best management practices, monitoring, and control efforts. The following are a few of the most common diseases that occur in the plant nursery. Leaf spot is a common descriptive term applied to a number of diseases affecting the foliage of ornamentals and shade trees. The majority of leaf spots are caused by fungi, but some are caused by bacteria. Gray mold, or botrytis blight, is a fungus capable of living on both dead and live plant material. It often occurs on more tender plant tissues, including flowers, buds, and leaves, with weakened and damaged tissue being the more susceptible. The affected tissue appears wet and turns tan to brown in color, with young fuzzy growth appearing white to gray. Anthracnose diseases are usually characterized by leaf spots and blight. Diagnosing anthracnose can be challenging since many people do not recognize that the leaf spots and cutting rot found in propagation are due to the same pathogen as shoot dieback later in the production cycle. They can form in concentric rings and look like a pincushion under magnification. Rusts are named for the dry, gelatinous, orange, reddish, or yellowish fruiting bodies and spore masses that form on the undersides of leaves on infected tissue on many species. Damping off is a fungal disease that causes mortality during the first few weeks after germination. The soil and seedborne fungi associated with the disease are not host-specific, and they cause rapid decay and mortality of germinating seeds and emerged seedlings. Downy mildews are pathogenic water mold, oomycetes, that primarily damage foliage. Downy mildew causes pale green to yellow areas on the upper surface of leaves and fluffy masses of brown, gray, or purplish spores on the underside of leaves under moist conditions. Downy mildew can be confused with powdery mildew, such as on roses. However, grayish downy mildew spores are almost always limited to the underside of leaves, and viewed under magnification, its spores occur in branch stalks, sporangia, like tiny trees. Powdery mildew is common on both sides of the leaves and produces spores on chains, and its whitish to gray growth is typically more extensive and prominent than with downy mildew. Powdery mildews are fungi and downy mildews are oomycetes, not fungi, which partly explains why their biology and management differ. Fungi that cause needle blight, dieback, and cast, premature drop, are weak pathogens. Even when environmental, plant, and fungal characteristics coincide to favor needle disease, usually only the foliage produced during a single season is damaged or drops prematurely, so trees rarely suffer severe stress or are killed. Petal blight attacks only open flower parts. Small brown spots first appear on petals, which enlarge and eventually cover the whole petal. Hard brown to black fungus bodies, sclerotia, develop in the base of old infected flowers, which can survive for 4 years. Because most nurseries have distinct areas for stock plants, propagation, and production, the practices of prevention, monitoring, and control will be discussed for each area. Land designated for stock plant establishments should be cleared of all roots of hardwood species, especially native oaks. Residual root debris and soil often serves as a food source for the shoestring and mushroom root rot fungi. If soil-borne diseases have been a problem in the past, such as bacterial crown gall and root knot nematode, the land should not be used for stock plants, or the grower could apply a broad-spectrum pre-plant soil fumigant or nematicide. Field-grown stock plants must allow adequate spacing between plants. The spacing will allow rapid drying of foliage, impede the spread of pathogens and other pests among plants, and facilitate better spray coverage of pesticides. Application of irrigation water should be managed to supplement natural rainfall. This will avoid saturated soils or drought conditions that can stress root systems. Plant stress is a predisposing factor to root diseases. For woody ornamental species with persistent foliar disease problems, Irrigation should occur between mid-morning and early afternoon. Wetting foliage prior to night hours should be avoided. Daytime watering has been shown to reduce foliar disease severity for some species. Precautions should be taken to ensure that stock plants remain healthy. Isolate all new stock plants to determine their health status prior to introduction into the existing nursery stock block. Propagation cycles of a particular species should be timed to maximize the most rapid rooting for that species. This would limit exposure to cuttings to potential cutting or root rotting organisms. Water sources should always be checked for contamination by root rotting fungi. Water from shallow sources such as ponds, rivers, creeks, canals, irrigation recycling ponds, or shallow wells should not be used for misting your irrigation and propagation facilities. Collect cuttings from tops of healthy plants. Top cuttings are usually less likely to have soil-borne pathogens. Avoid the use of root divisions unless absolutely necessary. If knives or pruning shears are used to collect cuttings, each worker should use two separate tools, one left soaking in disinfectant while the other is being used. As a suggestion, a household bleach solution, 1 part bleach to 9 parts water, or 70% alcohol is effective. The solution should be changed every 30 minutes since the disinfecting qualities diminish rapidly. Keep in mind that bleach solution will cause rusting on ferrous metals. Therefore, thoroughly clean cutting blades twice daily. Frequent sharpening is also a must. Place cuttings on chemically disinfected surfaces of benches, flats, and baskets. A chlorine bleach solution is a good surface disinfectant. Occasional use of copper naphthenate 2% will disinfect wooden surfaces. Some growers spread newspaper wrapping paper on disinfected work surfaces for added insurance. Never place cuttings on the ground. Never dip cuttings in water unless the water is pathogen-free. This is a disadvantage of the liquid rooting hormone formulations. Some growers dip or soak cuttings in a fungicide suspension prior to sticking. Change the solution as often as economically possible to maintain disinfecting concentrations. Flats should be disinfected either after propagation or before reuse. Thoroughly remove rooting media adhering to the surface of flats or other containers with a brush before placing in disinfectant. Chlorine bleach or 2% copper naphthenate solution. Galvanized metal or plastic trays are preferred over wood because they are easy to clean and disinfect. Never reuse propagating media. Media should be loose, porous, and well aerated. If propagation mixes contain soil or ground beds are used, pre-treat before use with a fumigate or pasteurization. Media must be stored so that it does not become contaminated with disease-causing organisms. Propagation media should be mixed on a clean concrete slab situated so that runoff water, such as rainwater, will not introduce pathogens. Remember that a clean medium can be contaminated if carelessly handled or subjected to foot traffic. Apply fungicide spray on a regular schedule to aid in the control of diseases that occur above ground. If needed, root media may be drenched immediately before or after sticking and at 4-week intervals with a fungicide combination developed to control water mold such as Rhizoctonia species and other fungi. Avoid unnecessary handling of clean media in the propagation containers or bags. Avoid dipping hands in the media while conversing or checking moisture content. Workers should wash their hands after working with raw contaminated media, soil, or unclean plants to avoid introduction of pathogens. Space cuttings properly when sticking. Poor air circulation contributes to an environment that favors diseases caused by Rhizoctonia species. Avoid excessive overhead irrigation. Growers should regulate their misting schedules to reduce misting on plants 2 hours before sunset. On rainy, humid days, misting frequency should be reduced earlier in the day. Wet foliage and high moisture regimes in brooding mixes provide a favorable environment for certain serious diseases. The basic concepts described previously in the propagation program are applicable to liner production. Liners should be elevated above ground to prevent contamination by soil-borne pathogens. All sanitation program efforts made previously are wasted if plants are placed directly on the ground. Contaminated soil is often splashed into containers, and this often leads to disease development. Growers should place containers on a prepared surface covered with a plastic covering or plastic sheet covered with crushed stone. Keep nozzles off the ground and clean and disinfect surfaces prior to use. If you must purchase liners, it is important that you obtain high-quality, disease-free plants. A large concrete pad is essential for mixing and storing potting media. It should be constructed high enough above the surrounding area to avoid contamination by runoff water. Mixing media on the ground often results in contamination by pathogens, pests, and weeds. Choosing the right components for the potting mix can also influence the development of disease. Care must be given to provide adequate drainage, water holding capacity, and aeration for the production of healthy roots. The wrong medias can provide environmental conditions that promote disease development. Woody species that are commonly affected by diseases can be grouped in adjacent areas within the nursery. This will offer greater ease in monitoring and more rapid detection of diseases. Consider combining blocks of disease problem plants together for midday watering, which will minimize the actual hours the foliage remains wet. This practice reduces the potential for foliar diseases. Nursery crop production is conducive to a disease epidemic if early stages of disease development are not detected. Efficient and systemic disease monitoring practices must be incorporated as a priority into the production system. The stock plant area should be routinely monitored every 2 to 4 weeks throughout the growing season. 2 months prior to taking cuttings, this routine inspection should occur weekly. Inspect the plants in a random fashion, check new and old growth, but concentrate predominantly on the new, more susceptible growth. Examine both leaf surfaces for disease symptoms. Observe leaves for a decrease in size, change of color, or general loss in vigor. These symptoms could indicate lower stem or root problems. Record where diseases occur and their precise location in standard blocks. This could help in the planning of future monitoring and control activities. Propagation beds should be routinely inspected on a 1 to 2 day interval while plants remain in the cycle. Be sure misting systems function properly and examine rooting medium for water saturation. Examine seedlings or cuttings for damping off disease. Propagation beds should be inspected for localized spots of root or cutting and rot disease. Plants purchased from outside the nursery should be placed in a holding or quarantine area for at least 3 weeks. Monitor these plants for weeds, insects, and diseases so those problems can either be corrected or the plants discarded to prevent introduction into the entire nursery. A minimum of 5% of the total plant production area should be monitored every 10 to 14 days. The monitoring frequency and number of plants should be adjusted based on past experience and the time of year. When a particular disease is detected on several plant species, all other known susceptible species should be carefully examined. Record all disease observations and associated production problems for future monitoring and control activities. When specific diseases cannot be accurately diagnosed on the site, collect and submit appropriate samples to a plant disease diagnostic laboratory in your state. Selective pruning or handpicking of disease foliage can often control localized disease problems in stock plants easily and rapidly. A thorough cleaning of all infected plants and uninfected plant debris should be included. Stock plants with severe disease problems such as crown gall or mushroom root rot should be rogued from the stock plant area. Control measures for foliar diseases should be initiated rapidly to ensure that cuttings used in propagation are free from disease. Areas with declining or dead plants because of root diseases within propagation beds should be carefully removed and quickly sealed in large plastic bags, including all of the rooting media. Certain root-rotting fungi such as Sclerotium rolfsii or Rhizoctonium solani will produce an asexual reproductive structure called a sclerotium. These structures are quite small and can easily be moved from one site in the propagation bed to another. Extreme care should be taken when roguing individually infected plants. Severe root rot diseases of plants in propagation beds do not affect all plants. Some will survive. These surviving plants should be discarded. Most growers, however, will want to take the risk and try to salvage the survivors. Be sure to treat the potting mix with an appropriate fungicide as a protective measure. Rooted liners exhibiting foliar disease symptoms should be sprayed with an appropriate fungicide before introducing into the production area and resprayed on a regular basis. Chemical control of most fungal diseases depends on the application of fungicides before the pathogen arrives. Fungicides used this way are referred to as protectants. Most broad-spectrum fungicides are this type. Protectants prevent fungal spores from germinating or kill them as they germinate prior to penetrating the plant surface. Most protectant fungicides are not absorbed by the plant, forming a protective barrier over the surface of the plant. Protectant fungicides are normally applied on a 7 to 14 day interval but more frequent applications may be necessary in periods of heavy rains or frequent overhead irrigation. Recent technology has produced several fungicides that are absorbed and translocated within the plants. This type of fungicide is called a systemic. Even though systemics are translocated onto new growth, they are essentially protectant fungicides. A few systemic fungicides destroy pathogenic fungi after the infection occurred. These fungicides are called eradicants or therapeutants. Their effectiveness is limited to a period of a few hours or days following infection. Fungicide selection and application must be based on the results of a good monitoring program and the latest and most accurate recommendations. Severely diseased plants should be rogued from the production site and appropriately discarded. Plants that must be rogued specifically are those with root rot, crown gall, and blight. This is especially important since chemical controls for these diseases are unsatisfactory. Frequent and excessive irrigation will favor the continued reproduction and spread of these fungal pathogens. Therefore, proper water management must be recognized as an important facet of disease management. When root diseases exist, avoid water or fertility extremes. Both will place additional stress on an already weakened plant. Systemic fungicides are more effective than protectant fungicides. These compounds affect the target fungus and plant tissue. Drenched fungicides applied to soil to control root rotting fungi should be deposited in and on the growing medium and not applied on foliage. If these products are applied through overhead irrigation, they should be washed off by additional water. Moisture content of growing medium should be near container capacity when a fungicide drench is applied. Avoid applications to very dry mixes because this can cause severe root damage. Some biological controls for soil-borne diseases exist and can be applied as dips or drenches. Some diseases occurring on aerial portions of plants can be controlled by selective shearing or pruning of infected plant parts. Removal of severely blighted leaves will improve the efficacy of subsequent fungicide applications. Most foliar fungal pathogens require long periods of leaf wetness if infection is to take place. This is one reason that late afternoon rainfall or irrigation is not good. When foliar disease severity is high, minimize the overhead irrigation cycle. Many disease treatments necessitate coverage on both leaf surfaces to be effective. Leaf underside coverage with protectants is particularly important with certain fungal pathogens that reproduce from the lower leaf surface. Irrigate plants prior to spraying to allow the longest contact of pesticide and foliage prior to the next watering. In conclusion, monitoring and controlling diseases is very important in nursery production because a disease can spread quickly with few initial symptoms. Put into place the best management practices in order to prevent and avoid diseases.